Let's start.
Good evening, Sam sir, and good morning, I rather, and good evening, Ravindra, and all our friends. It's my great privilege to introduce a man who needs no introduction. Sam Pitroda is a legend in the field of telecom. He's a man who's brought a transformative change in telecom in India, a visionary, and I would say an architect of modern India in the field of telecommunication. As a child, when we were growing up, I remember telephone was a luxury for people in the cities and in especially tier two cities that I came from. And in the late 80s, we saw a transformative change in telecom because of the vision of our late Prime Minister and the work done by Sri Sam Pitroda in the field of telecom, where he brought telephones to every nook and corner of the country. I think it's very rare that we find people like Sam sir, who combines the knowledge of a person like Albert Einstein and the morality and ethics of one of the greatest men that walked the planet Earth, Mahatma Gandhi. Sam sir also takes inspiration from Bapu, and it's always a pleasure to interact with Sam sir and learn from him. I've been fortunate to be associated with him for almost 7 years now. Many of us here in this group have read so much about him and his achievements, but it's not when you can it's when you interact with the person and have experiences that you can gauge the greatness of this man. I would like to share one anecdote I had with Sam sir. I think when he took over as Overseas Congress President in 2016, 2017, he came to New Jersey. Sam sir, please let me tell this
You know, we don't
anecdote.
need to glorify anything. Please, just I'm
Yes,
an ordinary
sir.
fellow.
1 minute, 2 minutes,
Believe me,
please, 2
I feel
minutes.
that way. Very.
Please, let me tell this anecdote. Let me tell
You're
this
very
anecdote.
generous. You're very
Thank
generous.
you.
Okay.
No, he had come to New Jersey and he was doing a Facebook Live with Gujarat people. And the person who was supposed to help him in the Facebook Live did not turn up. And Sam sir said, Rajinder, can you help me? And he told me to come to his hotel at 4:30 in the morning. And like Ramendra, I was very excited. Like a school kid, I got up at 3 o'clock, had my shower. I was expecting to knock at the door and wake up Sam sir at 4 o'clock. So I would go to his hotel, I knock at his door, and he opens the door. He already had his bath, he's already in his suit, and he says, "Good morning, would you like to have a cup of coffee?" I said, "This man is much younger to me in age. I mean, not in age, in spirit, sorry." And so this is the type of passion Sam sir brings to his work. He's been awarded the Padma Vibhushan. He's been given the Lal Bahadur Shastri Award for outstanding contribution to telecommunication. And International Telecommunication Union has awarded him excellence in telecommunication, the first for any Indian. Again, it is my honor to introduce my chairman, the chairman of Overseas Congress, and the former advisor to the Prime Minister of India, Sam Pitroda ji here, along with my friend Ramendra. Both are great fighters. Both are fighting different many battles, including health issues. And I salute you for your spirit, sir. Both of you, amazing people. So thank you so much. And I give the stage to Ramendra. Ramendra, please take over from here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Thank
Raj, for
you.
this lovely opening remarks. Good evening, Sam Pitroda, sir, and hi, friends. So I bought this book on Rajinder, my friend, on his recommendation, and I was slightly apprehensive. I thought it'll be, like I was just sharing with Sam, sir, a kind of an abstruse tome, a kind of an esoteric book, which would be filled with jargon and stats. But when I started reading it, I was in for a very pleasant surprise. as a writer and a performing performance storyteller myself, I found that this book is quintessentially a story which is engaging, which is riveting, and which has values skillfully woven into the tapestry. Sir, the vision you have outlined, the immediacy which you have reiterated, I feel needs to be shared with every citizen of the world. Let me straight away move to the first question. Sir, how and when did you get the idea of writing this book, Redesign the World?
Thank you, Ramendra. Thank you, Rajendra, for your very generous comments. Thank you for the opportunity. I sincerely appreciate putting together a program like this where we can talk to a group of friends about my book. Before I begin, I must say that the love and affection I get from people in India and outside India of Indian origin is something remarkable. I find Indian people to be very generous in their love, praise, and affection. And I feel it will take a lifetime of work to pay that debt. The kind of love and affection you get is absolutely unbelievable. And I'm thankful to every one of them. The idea of the book has been on my mind for quite some time. When I wrote my biography, which was published in 2015, I started thinking about sort of beginning of an end of a journey. You know, I'm 80 years old now, and I felt analyzing in very different way my own experiences. And in the process, I realized that the world was last designed just about the time I was born, in 1942. And then when I map my own experiences in telecom, IT, birth of transistor, microprocessor, software, where I had frontline seat in IT and telecom revolution, I realized that something profound has happened and we haven't paid enough attention to it. And that was about connecting everybody. For the first time in the human history, we are all connected essentially. We have 8 billion phones for 8 billion people. Not that everyone has telephone, but the fact is that something like this had never happened. Today, communication is instant and distance is dead. What does this really mean to human civilization? Is it only about cost reduction, efficiency, productivity, data, AI, blockchain? Or it's little more than all of that to take human civilization to the next level? That's the question I asked. The question was, are we using this hyperconnectivity to really take our civilization to the next level, or we are using hyperconnectivity just for productivity, efficiency, cost reduction, and all of that? Because this hyperconnectivity is very different. It democratizes information, it decentralizes decision making and implementation, it demonetizes services like education, travel, and all that. And at the same time, it is about content, context, curation, and also about connectivity. So on one hand, I felt the design that we put in place 80 years ago doesn't make sense today. And on the other side, I saw hyperconnectivity as an opportunity to redesign the world. That design was essentially led by US, which gave birth to UN, World Bank, IMF, NATO, WTO, WHO, and at the same time gave birth to parameters like GDP, GNP, though they were there, but it sort of put in front of the measurements of the progress in a country. That design worked well for a long time. Design was conceived when the world was in ruin. Japan had to be rebuilt. Europe had to be rebuilt. And as a result, everyone agreed to this design. And design at the core was essentially based on democracy, human rights, capitalism, consumption, and military. Then the world was divided into two. You had Soviet Union with exactly opposite paradigm, and you had US. And you had to be either with US or with Soviet Union. That was the general thinking. This design lifted millions out of poverty, stabilized the world, peace prevailed, mostly. Longevity increased, infant mortality decreased. Technology got democratized and became pervasive. But at the same time, this design hasn't solved the major problems of the world. Poverty, hunger, inequality, and finally environmental climate. This design has really created massive environmental. Okay. So I believe this design has outlived its utility. And it is time now to look at a new design. That's how this book was thought through. So to answer your question, it has been around, the thought has been around for quite some time. Finally, during Corona crisis, like all of us, I was in self-quarantine at home for a long time. And I decided to use that time to write this book. And I'm glad that finally it is out. And now the challenge is to spread this message around. You know.
So. Hello, I would request everybody to mute their microphones. There is a lot of dissonance, disturbance.
Yeah, go ahead.
Please continue.
So I think to answer your question, you know, again, I thought of this book 5-7 years ago. Finally decided to write during quarantine while I was at home because of Corona crisis. And now the book is out. And, you know, the hope that people read it, understand it, and begin new conversation. That's the idea.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Once again, let me request the audience to please mute your microphone because it is creating a lot of disturbance. We have all gathered here to listen to one of our most iconic visionaries, and let's not waste any time in creating dissonance. So you have just actually preempted or said what I wanted to ask you, because you said that you wanted this book to begin conversations. Now that's such a beautiful way of talking about a book. And you are you have been saying that you want to focus on two things, right? Humanity should focus on two things, planet and people. So could you elaborate on that, sir?
You see, after the design was put in place, lots of things happen in this world. First, Mahatma Gandhi-led independence movement decolonized the world completely. No one ever thought that world will get decolonized in a short span of 25 years. Then rise of China, fall of Soviet Union, rise of technology, rise of inequality or increase in inequality. Then 9/11, and finally, Corona crisis. Corona crisis basically tells us that we are all interconnected, interwoven, interdependent. Physical borders don't mean anything. What happens in one little part of the world affects everybody. No one ever thought that the entire world could be put to halt by a small little virus in the middle of nowhere. No one thought that economy world over will be completely paralyzed with one little incident that happened in a small little place in China. So when you look at all of this, you realize that at the end of the day, and especially for someone like me who is now in his 80s, is that we spend our life chasing rainbows. We want prestige, we want, you know, money, we want fame, name, you know, all that stuff. But at the end of the day, really two things matter: planet and people. I was talking the other day to a friend of mine in Delhi, and we talked about some of the prices of the homes. And people buy homes in Delhi for 500 crore. And I said, look, what good is that home if you can't breathe fresh air? So environment matters. Money don't matter. Okay. So we need fresh air to breathe, clean water to drink. We need animals, birds, bees, because they are all part of a larger ecosystem. We can't survive by ourselves. Planet doesn't need us. We need planet. So if we don't take care of our planet, in the long run, we won't be around. Look at what is going on with global warming, climate crisis. You know, now people are talking about carbon neutral by 2070, 2060, 2050. And we know the effect of climate change, whether it is tornadoes, fires, droughts, floods, you name it. And the costs are huge. So planet and earth and environment is the key. After that, people matter. We are all same. We may look different. In fact, the beauty of this world is that we are all different. Even in one family, people are different. You know, I have 8 brothers and sisters and we are all different. I have 2 kids and they are very different. Everyone is unique. There are 8 billion human stories to be told in this world. And every story is unique. So we need to respect people, give them dignity, give them support. And at the end of the day, people matter. It doesn't matter what religion you follow, what color you are, where you live. And that, to me, is the key to redesigning the world. You know, today, we are in a mess all over the world. You know, in India, you still have in 2021, Dalits, religious conflicts. Look at all this tamasha that is being made of temples and, you know, Kasi and all this stuff. Fine, it's great. But in the process, you are dividing people. Here in America, we have Black Lives Matter. After hundreds of years of slavery, we have still not been able to solve that problem. In Chicago, where I have lived for 57 years, you go in the south side of it, it's a different world. It's a very different world in terms of crime, drug, poverty, hunger, you name it. Why? Because we have not been able to build a society which is inclusive. So when you think of two things, planet and people, you essentially have to think of sustainability and inclusion. If we don't focus on sustainability, we will not be able to take care of our planet. And if we don't take care of our, if you want to take care of our people, you have to think of inclusion. Everybody has to be included. Problems have to be solved through collaboration, cooperation, co-creation, communication, and not through confrontation, not through authoritarian attitude. Because I personally believe that the hyperconnectivity brings about democratization. And you need to promote democratic values and not authoritarian values. And these are some of the things I discuss in the book.
Thank you, sir. How should I say? So beautifully put in such a novel way, planet and people, just two words that would, and sustainability and inclusion, that kind of sums up anything and everything we should be discussing, but we are, I think, failing to. So all these points, you've brought them together in such a simple way, which anybody and everybody can understand and internalize and imbibe. So taking a cue from what you have mentioned, you have talked in the book about Mahatma Gandhi's concept of trusteeship. Now, COVID has taught us that it is man who's the intruder, not nature. And more man intrudes, the price tag gets higher and more vicious. I think Gen Next should be made to realize that they are only trustees and not owners of the environment. If they don't realize, possibly there won't be a tomorrow for them to realize this. So your take on this?
Agree with you 100%. You know, somewhere in the book, I talk about the fact that my grandparents gave me a world that was poor, simple, but clean. We could go drink water from river. Today you can't do that. We could breathe fresh air. There were forests. There were animals. And life was very different just about 70 years ago, 75 years ago. I'm living for my grandchildren world that is complex, that is rich, but polluted. And I'm not happy about that. I wish I would be leaving behind for my grandchildren a world that was simple and clean. It's not true. Look at all the complexity through which a 2-3-year-old child goes through. Stimuluses are too many interactions. When we were little, there were no interactions like that. It was very calm. Brain grew up as a child in a very simple environment. These kids are seeing colors and sounds and interactions and television and, you know, all kinds of images. And I don't think little brain sometimes can deal with it. Okay. As a result, children don't get the right kind of environment. They don't get to play. So lots of things have changed. I hope we find new answers. And I would like to leave for my grandchildren a world which is definitely far better in environment than I'm living.
Absolutely, sir. And as we often discuss, that the childhood is no more there. You know, even when we were growing up, we had so much to play. We had, and our lives were so uncluttered. You know, and they were so simple. But now, like you mentioned so rightly, it's becoming so complex. Mahatma Gandhi said, "You move from complex to simple," and we are going at a breakneck speed the other way around, and it's going to lead to complete chaos.
Absolutely. Simplicity is very complicated.
That's very well said, sir. That's very well said. Quotable quote. So you also talked about two imperatives, a new version of democracy and a truly global institution in the book. So could you elucidate on these two aspects?
See, the democracy today has been hijacked by many world leaders. Their idea of democracy is get enough votes, be in control, and do what you think you want to do. That's not what democracy is all about. Democracy is all about openness, accessibility, connectivity, networking, democratization, decentralization. Democracy is all about people's participation. So we really need to now use hyperconnectivity to take democracy to the next level. We need to decentralize everything possible. And we need to increase people's participation. To me, in democracy, three things matter. Of course, constitution and all that is given. But one, institutions. All institutions in democratic system should be independent, autonomous, whether it is judiciary or it is security, police, or university, education. Institutions should function on their own without any political overtone
interference.
Two, civil society has to play an important role as watchdog. Civil society must be at the table. In most democracies today, politicians and business decide what is good for everybody and not civil society. Civil society is never at the table. They are seen as NGOs, jolliwala, who just wander around. Not true. They are in the field. They are close to people. And they have to have a seat at the table. And third, we need scientific thinking. We need rational, logical approach. It cannot be shouting at each other on television and pointing fingers and finding faults and hitting your opponent for no reason. That's not a civilized discussion. So you need logical, scientific thinking. If you focus on these three, you'll go a long way in taking democracy further. And all these three things are being attacked in many countries. So I think democracy is the key going forward. And there are different forms of democracy. Democracy doesn't mean same thing to everybody. At the end of the day, do people feel that they are participating in the process? Is press independent? Is media really bringing public view or tooting government horn all the time? These are all simple issues. We know the results. And that's what democracy is all about.
So you also mentioned about this, a new global institution. You've said that the WHO and the UNO, they have kind of either become anachronistic or have outlived their utility in the true sense of the term?
I think it is time to think about new global institutions. The institutions we have done well, we respect that. Some of these institutions need to be restructured, but we definitely need new global institutions. And I talk about a few in the book. You know, I file a lot of patents, and every time I file a patent, it is a mess in terms of global coverage. I have to file a patent in US, I have to file a patent in Europe, which is PCT, I have to file them in every country. You know, I have to decide whether Italian translation, Chinese translation, Japanese translation, all that stuff, it's bogus. And then every country decides whether it is patentable or not. And every country has their own little regulations. If the business is global, patent should be global. I should be able to file patent in one place. If that patent is allowed, it should work in every country. Why isn't patent system totally global? Because all the lawyers and everybody who has vested interest do not want this to happen. Because the guy who is translating the patent gets $5,000 to translate. He's not going to agree to that. So you have a lot of vested interests everywhere. In this world, we have 200 different currencies. Does it really make sense to have 200 different currencies in a globalized world? Physical borders do not mean anything. What are the rights of a digital citizen? You know, I have a small group that I work with now where we are really trying to define human rights in a digital world. Because today's human rights, as defined by UN, are meant for physical world. What does it mean to be a digital citizen? What is my role? What is my responsibility? What is my obligation? I could be living in America, but working somewhere else and getting salary somewhere else. Where do I pay tax? What is the definition of my residency? Is it where I physically live or is it where I work 10 hours a day? All of these questions are not answered yet properly. And we need new institutions to answer these questions. We need new judiciary system at a global level. We need to really define, to some extent, global constitution, where we agree to minimum rules and regulations that we need to follow about respect for life, respect for our environment. These are fundamental issues that everybody should follow. So we need new global institutions. We need to redo existing institutions. But for that, we need to be clear as to what is that we are trying to accomplish. Look at what is going on with global warming and climate control. We had our first meeting in Brazil, we meaning the world. We had the last meeting in Glasgow, COP26, and we haven't accomplished anything in the last 25 years except conversation. Lot of debate, lot of gyrations, but what is the result? Now we have said India will become carbon neutral in 2070, China in 2060, and US in 2050. Can we live with that? Do we need a global institution which will basically settle the issue? So there are lots of challenges today as we go from disconnected world to a connected world. And I think that's where hyperconnectivity plays an important role. We are all connected. We can work anywhere, live anywhere, and we can have multiple loyalties. You know, when I hear on television, people say, oh, you're anti-national. What does it mean to be anti-national? What does it mean to be a national? I would rather be human first than national. Okay. When a little child is dying, I'm not going to ask his nationality. Okay. So I think these are some of the fundamental issues that we need to rethink through. We cannot go back to history to get inspiration all the time. We need to look at future to get inspiration. And there are very few people who are looking at the future to get inspiration. They want to go to 5,000-year-old history to get inspiration. And that's where I have a question. Okay.
That is so brilliantly put. Yeah, Rajendra.
Sir, I have a question, sir.
This are we opening up for a question now? Let Rajendra decide.
I have a request.
Let Rajendra decide when to open up for questions.
Yes.
We will open up the questions after some time.
Right.
I would request everybody to put their questions in the chat box, not come on the screen, because it creates some kind of dissonance.
Okay.
And the second thing is, please ask direct questions. Comments are definitely welcome, but direct questions would be far more inviting, because then Sam sir can address the particular issue.
I'll let you handle that, Rajendra. But I thought you finished, then we can open up for question answer.
Yeah. I'm still please, a few questions continue. Left.
Continue.
So you have given an entirely new and refreshing take on GDP, reminded me of the Bhutanese king. I don't know how to pronounce his name, Jigme Singhai Wangchuck. He talked about gross domestic happiness, not the GDP, which the way we define. So do you have your own views on this particular thing?
So I think I'm aware of what Bhutan experiment is all about. I've read enough about it. The point is, GDP is definitely not the ultimate measurement. It is one which worked. Now we need to really look at gross environmental product, gross happiness product, gross human development product. There are multiple things we need to look at, and we have technology to really look at all of these in a very effective way. Earlier, GDP worked because it was a gross measurement, and we didn't have the tools to make any finer measurements. Just because your GDP is high doesn't mean you are happy, healthy,
correct,
educated. Look at America. In America, we have largest number of people in prison.
Yeah, you mentioned that.
Percentage-wise. Okay. Now, is that acceptable? No, it's not acceptable. Why do we have largest number of people in prison? Because of inequality. So you could be rich. I was in San Francisco recently, and you see the number of people on the street living is amazing. It's very large. It is one of the richest cities in the world, where there are a large number of billionaires and multimillionaires because of all these new high-tech companies. And there are people on the street, hungry, no homes. Now, is that acceptable? Can we tolerate that? What are we doing about it? So I think it all depends on how you look at the world. At the end of the day, world is all about making choices. Life is all about making choices. What choices you make? Do you want to make that choice that, fine, they can go hungry and I'm going to just go on a corporate jet and fly all over the world for lunch? It's okay if that's the choice you make. But can you live with that choice you have made? So I think we need to make the right choices. Even in India today, the real issue is, what choices are we going to make for India going forward? Okay. Are we going to make choices which depends on dividing people? Or we are going to make choices which depend on bringing people together? It is not about politics. It is about what you believe in. Okay. If you believe in this, fine. I have no problem. You go do that. Okay. I mean, look at, I've seen on television, young hoodlums beating people because they gave flower to their girlfriend on Valentine's Day. I mean, what kind of people are these? Okay. They are not allowing you to make simple choices of your own. And is that progress? So I think all of these things get confused with fundamentals.
True. So in the concluding portion of your book, you have given your manifesto of the redesigned world. And there you mentioned 10 global action points. Could you touch upon a few of these?
Okay, at the end of the day, what do I mean by redesign the world? And what is my proposal? It's okay to say world needs to be redesigned. It's okay to say this is wrong and that is wrong, but what's the solution? So I propose that we need to take first democracy to inclusion. I'm a strong believer in democracy. I'm a strong believer in the fact that hyperconnectivity is going to really empower every human being, because this thing is not about telephone. It's about empowering an individual. So until we take democracy to inclusion, we haven't achieved the human potential. So first part of the design is to take democracy to inclusion. That means you need institutions on inclusion. You need to focus on inclusion. You need policies that define and direct movement toward inclusion. Second, I believe human rights are not good enough. You need to provide human needs. And we can produce anything today. We need to decide what is that we want to produce and for whom do we want to produce. We live in an economy of surplus and not of scarcity. So we must focus on providing basic human needs. Today we spend $2 trillion a year on defense, while we know that it costs only $200 billion a year to eliminate hunger completely. Three, capitalism hasn't done well for everybody. We need new economy. We need new way to distribute wealth. We need to generate wealth in rural areas or shift from urban to rural. Today, all wealth is generated in urban areas. Why aren't we generating wealth in rural areas? Because we don't have the right policies. We don't have the right focus. So everybody wants to come to urban areas for jobs and opportunities and prosperity. Nobody wants to go to rural area for jobs and prosperity. Four, focus on consumption is not the answer. We need focus on conservation and sustainability. So these are four key areas to redesign the world. So we need to shift our attention. And finally, which is a very tall order, we need to think of nonviolence. We have created a violent world. There is violence at home. There is violence on street. There is violence in our games. Look at all the video games. It's all about violence. We teach violence in school. And we need to focus on nonviolence. That means we need a global institution on nonviolence. We need to make nonviolence part of the study in schools and colleges.
Okay. True.
So these are the five new parameters for the redesign. Inclusion, basic needs, new economy, conservation and sustainability, and nonviolence. Now, for this, we need new structure. These are not just ideas. This will require new organizational architecture at national level, international level. Look at all our ministries, how they are structured. It don't make sense to have a ministry of shipping or steel or railways anymore. I mean, it was okay 100 years ago, 50 years ago. Today, you need Ministry of Nonviolence. Why isn't there a Ministry of Nonviolence? Why isn't there a Ministry of Inclusion? So I think we need to change everything around us. And hyperconnectivity is giving us an opportunity to rethink through. We need innovation. We need innovation in education, innovation in health, innovation in governance, innovation in, you know, manufacturing. Everywhere we need to use hyperconnectivity to redefine the paradigm.
That's so nicely put, sir. And when you talk about the absence of the Ministry of Nonviolence, I think one reason could be because nonviolence is not good business, but violence is huge business. And this you have also mentioned, the arms deals and all that.
Yeah, of course, of course. Yeah.
And you have said that when global leaders shake hands, it's like these marketing whiz kids, you know, shaking hands.
So yeah, of course, they're all there to make deals. They're all there to make deals.
They're all there to make deals. So we'll take three quick questions and then I'll come to my favorite round. And I'm so happy that you've agreed for a rapid fire where we'll go a little bit informal, even more informal. So the first
I believe there are 14 questions in the chat box.
Most of them are comments.
Okay.
But
fine.
I'm taking the specific questions.
Please.
Ishika Kiran, sir, do you think there's a possibility that tech advancements, especially the unquestioned development of surveillance systems, affect the functioning of a democracy negatively? I think this is a very pertinent question.
Agree with you. It all depends on what our leaders think is important. If they think command and control is important, as opposed to collaboration, cooperation, co-creation, and communication, they will misuse the tool. This is a tool, and it depends on how they want to use it or how we want to use it. We need to fight when this tool is being misused. In a democracy, you need to speak up and say, hey, this is not acceptable. So it depends. Okay.
Correct. So there's a question from Mr. Rajeshwar Reddy, who is asking, how do you define recent farmer protests and three farm laws with respect to your vision of the book or what you have mentioned in the book?
I am for the well-being of the farmers. I stand behind the needs of the Indian farmers. Indian farmers acted with Gandhian thought and started Satyagraha. I admire their courage. It was a peaceful demonstration. And to me, Indian farmers brought Gandhi back on the agenda. Indian farmers are asking for something that is natural. They want to protect their income, their family's well-being. They don't want to completely corporatize and give their business to big giants. I'm with the farmers. But we do need to modernize agriculture. We do need to bring technology in agriculture. We do need a lot more innovation in agriculture. Because at the end of the day, we have to increase income of the farmer. If farmers' income doesn't increase, we have not made a progress in rural India. So whatever helps to improve income of the farmer, even at the expense of increasing cost of living in urban areas, I would vote for it. But that's a personal. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Raj has a Rajender Dichapalli has a question, I think, which is very, very important. How do we provide equal opportunity to all people and set a level playing field in the future? A very holistic question.
I think it is all about democracy. Democracy is all about equal opportunity. Democracy is about, you know, making sort of opportunities available to everybody. It is access. Democracy is about increasing access. Okay. So the only way to increase opportunities and access is to really believe in democracy everywhere.
Okay. Right. So I just would like to show the cover of the book and say a few words before I move to the rapid fire section.
Sure.
So I would like to ask the viewers or tell the viewers that if you have loved John Lennon's Imagine, if you have liked or have been hooked by the speech of Charlie Chaplin in the concluding portion of The Great Dictator. If you are enamored by the vision of the Mahatma, the mission of Martin Luther King, then this book is for you. It will help you redesign your heart, mind, and soul. It will provoke you to make the world, take a small, tiny step to make the world a safer, saner place. It will compel you to take the first step now, not tomorrow.
Thank you. Thank you, Ramendra.
Thank you, sir. Moving to the rapid fire, very informal. If you were to invite the following on a dinner date, who would it be? Martin Luther King, Mahatma Gandhi, Einstein, Rajiv Gandhi, or Marilyn Monroe?
Mahatma Gandhi.
Okay, great. And I don't have to ask you why, because you are so much inspired by him. The book is inspired by him. You have followed his ideals. And even in today's talk, the silhouette of Mahatma was there throughout. So which is your favorite book across genres?
First of all, I'm not very good at reading a lot of books. You know, I read a lot of magazines and newspapers more so than books anymore. You know, I read books when I was very young, but I don't have time to read books anymore. I don't read novels. You know, I have no interest in novels. But I remember Germs, Steals, and what was the other word? The by Diamond. That's a book I really loved.
Okay, you like that. If you were given a chance to live your life all over again, which is one major thing you would change and why?
I would take care of my health a little better than I have done. Everything else is great.
Okay, that's so nice to hear. So your favorite film, any language, any country?
I don't watch movies at all.
I think that's why you can think so deeply.
No, it's not that. I just don't get time to watch a complete movie. I just, you know, sit with my wife once in a while. As soon as I watch, my mind goes somewhere else. So I'm not a big movie.
That's interesting. Your greatest success and your biggest failure, if you would like to share.
I don't look at life that way. Okay, I don't look at life in terms of success and failure. I look at life in terms of a journey. But if you have to say biggest success, I would say my family. I have great children.
That's so wonderful.
Wonderful two children, boy and girl. I have even better grandchildren. Mm-hmm. Believe me. And I'm not saying it for the sake of saying it. They are absolutely wonderful. Not because they are my grandchildren. But they live in a different world. You know, they amaze me with their curiosity, with their ability. And they are the children of the world. They are not just my grandchildren. They are grandchildren of the world. And I'm so happy and proud of all grandchildren. And I see, you know, walking on the street, I see somebody's little kid and I get excited. You know, yesterday I had gone out with some friends walking, even in this cold, in a big garden. And there are people with 6 months old baby walking there. And you look at the glimpse in the eye of a baby. And you say, wow, what a world we have created, you know?
So that's so beautifully put, sir. That's so poetic, absolutely poetic. Sir, how would you describe yourself in one sentence?
Just a normal human being, like everybody else, really. You know,
I get up
like everybody else. I have my tea and I eat my stuff and I do my work and I, you know, love my children and friends and wife. And, you know, I'm just a normal guy. I do everything that you do and I do. And, you know, it's just, that's it. You know, I may have three more black shirts. So what difference does it make? You
know? But I don't think anybody in the audience would say that you are ordinary by any stretch of imagination.
No, I genuinely believe, you know, because everybody has their own scale.
True.
Okay. And everybody is good in their own skill. You may be a great husband. You may be a wonderful father. You may be a great scientist. You know, the world is full of people. You may be a great painter. You may be a great poet. You know, So we got to celebrate all that rather than saying, oh, that guy's a little better and this guy's a little worse. That's not the point. We are all doing what we are supposed to do.
True.
A poor father is a good father. Okay. He may be poor. So don't judge him that he is not successful. Okay. So I think we need to learn to sort of, you know, not put people on pedestal unnecessarily. You know, we are all same. Some do better, some do less today, and it will change tomorrow. What goes up must come down. And what is down will come up. So don't get too excited. I'm never excited about celebrating success. It doesn't mean anything.
That again is a huge takeaway for me and Raj. Because when Raj started introducing you, you very gently, very lovingly admonished him that please don't say such things. I'm a very ordinary man.
Yeah, but I am. I really mean it. And I'm not saying it for the sake of saying it so it sounds good. Okay, I don't mean it. Okay. Look, just to give an idea. And, you know, I'm sorry to say it this way, but every morning when I get up, the first thing I do is sweep floor every day, 365 days. I take my jhadu, I clean up the house. My wife goes crazy, but I do that. I make my own bed. During quarantine, since I'm locked up in the house, I told my wife, I'm going to do all the cooking now. You have done all your life. Okay? So I make lunch. I make dinner. I do all of it at home. This is my work. Okay? I can afford to hire a cook. But why would I do that? What a dumb thing to do. What an insulting thing for somebody to say, come cook for me and serve me a dinner. I wouldn't do that. To me, that's just not thinkable. That I would have a servant to serve me food. It's an insulting to that other human being. Okay. That's my view. I may be wrong. You can argue and say, look, you are absolutely wrong. That's okay. But that's what I believe. I need to do my work.
So this again is very strongly inspired by Mahatma Gandhi.
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, like he says, I clean my bathroom. I do that all the time. Okay, and not that I'm doing something special. Not that I should be proud of it. Not said that, you know, that it is something to talk about. This is a normal thing to do, right? I press my own clothes. Okay, when I travel, you know, I would wash my socks and underwear myself in my room rather than giving it to laundry. Okay, I can afford to give it to laundry. And not that I'm trying to save money. That's also not the idea. The idea is you got to do your work. Okay.
That is so inspiring. That is so hugely motivating and inspiring. You deserve a big round of applause, though I'm sure you'll say that, please don't applaud me. I'm just an ordinary man. But sir, it is this ordinariness which makes you extraordinary. And Raj will agree.
I polish my own shoes. I polish my wife's shoes. Okay. I'll give you one simple example and then close it, perhaps. You know, when we were young, we had just gotten married. Okay. And, you know, I was 22-year-old, my wife was 21, and she had come from India. And there was an Indian movie being shown at a university in Chicago. So we were going to go to movie. Okay. And my wife had tears in her eyes. I said, what happened? She said, I remember my mom. Because if this was India, I would have gotten her to go to tailor and stitch me a new blouse so I could wear a new blouse to movie. And I said, okay. She had a sari, yellow sari, I still remember. I said, no big deal. This was about 2 o'clock and movie was at 7. So I took her blouse, one blouse. I cut the cloth. I stitched the blouse for her. She wore that blouse and we went to movie.
My God. Okay. Sir, I'm not going to show this video to my wife.
I'm just telling you, but this is how life works. Okay? And I've been married to that girl for, you know, 55 years.
That's so wonderful. But I'm not going to show this video to my wife. Well, I don't think I'll be able to stitch anything.
That. It's just, you got to do what you got to do.
But it's really, really so humble of you. And you're so, how should I say, grounded in every sentence which you utter. You're so grounded after having achieved so much in life. It's really inspiring, sir. It's really inspiring. Straight from the heart. It's really inspiring. And so my last rapid fire question is, what is your advice to Gen Next, the coming generations?
Build a good self. A self that is respectful, self that is loving, caring, honest, disciplined. That's all you can do. You know, don't try to change the world without changing yourself. Just be a decent human being. Respect everybody. You know, don't jump to conclusions. Don't make judgment on people. You know, it's nice to be different. Love everybody. Okay. And it's okay for somebody to insult you. It's perfectly okay. Don't worry about it. Don't get insulted. Nobody can insult you except yourself. Okay. People take things too seriously. Oh, this fellow said this to me. That fellow said that to me. It doesn't matter. Okay. You got to rise above all that. And you got to be comfortable with yourself. So I would like young people to build a good self. And if you want to learn a lesson on self, go to Gandhiji.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. You have outlined it so well in such a succinct way. I would like to take another question from Mr. Rajeshwar Reddy. He said that because of COVID-19, should the world go back to urbanization or follow the Gandhian mode of rural development or rural whatever?
So people live where they live. Large number of people live in rural areas, which is good. There's enough space. There is, you know, farming, water, birds, bees. We need localization. At the same time, we need globalization. We need decentralization. So I think if you prefer to live in rural areas, we should give you all the facilities possible. So rural development all over the world is very important. You cannot create jobs just in urban areas, and that is what has happened in the world. So the world has gotten more and more urbanized. What good is this world if nobody lives in forest and remote areas and nobody goes to farming? How are we going to eat? So I think you have to have this balance.
True, sir.
Life in rural area is much more
serene, pleasant. Calm.
Yeah, but there is no income. So you got to create income there.
True.
You know.
So this again is the Gandhian model, basically what you're talking about.
Absolutely. Yeah. Bottom up development as opposed to top down.
Top down. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. I think Raj has a question.
Yes.
No, no.
Okay. So I'll just propose a word of thanks and then a small piece I've written for Sam, sir, and his book. I would like to offer a truckload of thanks to Sam Pitroda, sir, for taking time off his schedule to engage with us. Sir, the insights which you have provided, I'm sure would stay with us for a long, long time. And in some small way, would leave imprints on our minds and souls. I think each of us would today has been changed, at least in a teeny meeny way, for the better. That is my strong belief. And thank you, sir, for this interaction. My thanks to Sam Pitroda, sir's very lively team who worked tirelessly to put this event together. I would like to thank Rajinder Dichpally for his opening remarks. And finally, tons of thanks to each one of you across the globe who tuned in to make this event successful and vibrant. It was your presence, in essence, which has made this session truly memorable. So I wish to end the session with a poem inspired by Rabindranath Tagore's Gitanjali. Sir, it is dedicated to you, your passion, and to this phenomenal book. where sustainability is the mantra and inclusion is held high. Where sustainability is the mantra and inclusion is held high. Where conversations begin anew. Where planet and people are the focus. Where conversations begin anew. Where planet and people are the focus. Not wealth, power, and pelf. Where science is the new religion and diversity, the only reality. Where science is the new religion and diversity, the only reality. Where hyper-connectivity dissolves boundaries and connects hearts. Where hyper-connectivity dissolves boundaries and connects hearts. Where there is a new vision of democracy and a truly global institution. Where there is a new vision of democracy and a truly global institution, such a redesigned world, let us all create. Such a redesigned world, let us all create. Thank you, sir.
Great. Thank you. Please write it down and we will tweet it.
Yeah. Yes. Very nice.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you, Rajeshwar Reddy. Good to see you. Thanks, Leela. Good to see you, Leela. Thank you, Rajendra.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your time, sir.
And thanks, Rakesh.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rakesh.
Bye-bye, sir.